boy, the Lord right here, man.
You see rebellion, that's a sign from the devil. When you walk in the church and that look, I do run the church, baby.
And you know, you said the sign of rebellion. And that's what I want to talk about today. The sign of rebellion, which is this. First of all, I salute y'all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. How y'all doing? I pray everybody is okay. I want to thank you for coming back to the channel. This is Idolatry is a Sin, Part 3. I hope that you watch part 1, part 2, and this is Part 3, and we might have a Part 4. And the reason why we're doing this is because I really want to take you deep into the scriptures that you can see how the Lord uncovered it and unraveled it to me to let me know that idolatry, man, in America is not even looked on as a sin. It's so normal, like it's, you know, it's okay, and it ain't okay, you know. And I believe it's my job, you know, just like God revealed it to me, you know, it's my job to reveal it to you, to whoever's watching this. I pray that whoever's watching this is going to get blessed from this, you know. And it's not so much me talking, but we're going to get into the scriptures to see, you know, how God feel about this. This is a sin, okay? So that's what this is about. Idolatry is a sin, and y'all know I'm pointing out the Catholic Church. But it ain't just the Catholic Church. I'm targeting the Catholic Church right now, but it's idolatry goes further than just the idols that you place in front of you in worship. You know, anything you put before God is an idol. You know, whether it be a basketball player, a movie star, your wife, your husband, your children, your mom, your dad. You know, you can't put nothing before Christ. Nothing, absolutely nothing can you put before God. You know, God said you can't serve two masters. You can only have one. Jesus says if you don't hate your mother, your father, your brother, your sister, and pick up your cross and follow me, you can't be my disciple. And we know that word hate, man, for those of y'all that hear that and don't understand it, you have to look that word up in the Greek. That word hate means loveless. You know, he still wants you to love your mother because he tells you to honor your mother and your father. But we don't put nobody before Christ. If Christ tells us to do something, we do it. And we don't care what mama or daddy or brother or sister or wife or husband feel about it. You know, and we love our family, but we love them less. We love God more. Because you know, if we put anything before God, that's an idol. It ain't no different than worshiping the Jesus statues and the Mary statues and all that. You know, it's an idol. But right now, I just want to stay focused on what we talked about. You know, we talked about, we covered a lot in part one and part two and part three. In part one and part two. Part two, we covered Manasseh. We saw that Manasseh was a king, you know, and he went into the house of God and he set up all these images and these idols. And he caused the people to worship them and serve them. And, you know, God dealt with them. God warned them first. He warned the people in the church first, you know, and they didn't listen. So then judgment came. You know, warning always come before destruction. Warning always come before judgment, man. And, you know, and God warned them. He ain't listen. They ain't listen. So God surrounded them by their enemies, and they hauled them off and put them into captivity. They was no longer free anymore. So with that being said, they lost their freedom. You know, the very thing that they loved, the very thing that they cherished, they loved that. They lost that, you know, and they lost it because they sinned. They sinned in the eyesight of God. So, you know, chastisement comes as a form of discipline, you know, and God is trying to get you back, you know, get you back on the right track because they got off track. So anyway, Manasseh sought the Lord in there, and he got right with him, and God gave him a second chance. He put him back out there in the street again, and he went in there, and the first thing he did was went back in the house of God, and he tore them idols down. He took all of them out and threw them and got rid of them. You know, we learned about King Asa. King Asa did that which was right, the Bible said. His heart was perfect with the Lord. And why was his heart perfect? What is it that he did that was right? He got rid of the Sodomites, the homosexuals, the gays, the LGBT. He got them out of the neighborhood. And then he went and got all them idols. He got rid of his mom for putting up the idols. She was a queen. She lost her job. She ain't no more queen no more. He fired her. And he did that because she set up an idol. So these idols are meant to be taken seriously, man. This is not as, you know, like it's okay, you know, like it is today. It's not, man. We lost focus of that. See, the thing is, God don't change. We change. Our views change. Our understanding change. But God's view stays the same. He said, for I am the Lord, I change not. Jesus says, I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. Yesterday represents the Old Testament. Today represents the New Testament. And forevermore, he's never going to change. The same way God felt about idols and images in the Old Testament, in the book of Exodus, is the same way he felt about it today. So that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to see how serious is this idolatry, all right? So let's go to First Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. We're going to start in verse 9, and we're going to see what this does the New Testament, because we've been talking about stuff in the Old Testament. So we're going to see what the New Testament has to say about idols. Because, you know, sometimes people will say, oh, Brother Joe, that's the Old Testament. We're not under the Old Testament anymore. Listen, everything that was written in the Old Testament was written for our learning and our example. Okay, so the things that was written in the Old Testament on how God felt about things and how God punished them about things, that's an example for us today. And that's what, okay, so we're in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. You ready? Let's go. And the Lord says, it says in 1 Corinthians 6 and 9, he says, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor infidels, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. Verse 10, he said, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, the list goes on, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. You know, it's a lot in that list, but the thing I want to focus on right now, yeah, and you pay attention to that list, because you can't be anything on that list when Jesus come back. And abusers of themselves with mankind is homosexuals, because that's what men are doing with other men. They're abusing their bodies. They're tearing their rectums up. Yeah, they're destroying that. I don't even want to go into that details, man, because that's so nasty and disgusting. I don't know how a person can feel that that's okay. These people are having bowel problems, man. When they got to use the bathroom, it's so loose down there, it just comes out. You know what I'm saying? And that's crazy. That comes from doing, you're abusing your bodies, you're abusing yourselves with mankind. That's not. Yeah, I don't even want to talk about that, man. That's so disgusting. I see what the Lord said, that's disgusting. That is disgusting, man. That really is, man. That really is. And if you're watching this, man, repent, man. If you're a homosexual, if you're a man and you're having sex with another man, repent, man. Turn away from that, man. That is the foul, unclean relationship, man. I don't care how the world paint a picture or try to justify it, or how these gay scientists come about and try to justify it. That is wrong, man. Get out of that relationship, man. That is a dirty, nasty, disgusting, stinking relationship, and you know it. You know it. If somebody, nobody have to tell you that. Your conscience will tell you that. So, I don't, you know, it's so much better for a man to be with a woman or for a woman to be with a man. That's what's right. That's what's right. You know, anyway, I'm going to have a study on that one day. We're going to talk about, this gay stuff, man, this lesbianism and all this stuff, man. And we're going to get out in the scripture and see what God has to say about that. Because I don't want you to think it's just me. You know, I don't agree with it. I never did agree with it. Even though I wasn't saved, I didn't agree with it. I guess it's just the way I grew up, man, and the area I grew up in, Chicago, man, that just wasn't accepted. That wasn't tolerated, you know. So just by the world, I knew back then that wasn't right. You know, it was right to be with a woman. That I knew. But when I came to God and came inside, realized, you know, the knowledge of the Word of God, I realized why. You know, I have a full understanding of that, and I know that's demonic spirits. You know, God ain't make you that way. That's a lie. Devil lying to you. Devil lying to y'all. God ain't made you that way. God made you to be a man. Anyway, so I'm going to read. We're in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. I'm going to read verse 9 and verse 10. And we're going to see what the Word of God has to say about an idolater. You know, where would an idolater make it into heaven? You know, I'm telling you right now, an idolater won't make it into heaven. That's why I'm making these videos. That's why I'm on the street. That's why I'm standing in front of the Catholic Church preacher. Cause I want to see everybody make it into heaven, man. I want all of us to go to heaven, man. It's sad that everybody ain't gonna go, but I don't know who gonna go, who don't go. So, you know, my thing is, man, is just this is a warning, man. I'm trying to show you, man, that what the Word of God say about that. You know, don't get caught up in this world's fake imagination or fake illusion that they could do this and still get into heaven. It doesn't matter. You can't do that. You can't get into heaven like that. So anyway, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. I'ma read verse 9. It says, know ye not that the unrighteous should not inherit the kingdom of God? First of all, Paul says, the Word of God says, that the unrighteous shall not, you will not, I don't care what people say, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. You won't get into heaven. Jesus told his disciples in John chapter 14, verse 1, he was explaining to them that he's going to go. He asked them first, he said, do you believe in God? If you believe in God, believe also in me. Then he told them that where he's going, he's going to prepare a place for them, that they will have a mansion. And he said, if he go to prepare a place for them, he's coming back. that where he is, there we may be also. So Jesus is coming back. He made a promise to us that when he go to heaven, he's going to go prepare a place for us. This is the kingdom of heaven. So that when he comes back, he'll receive us to himself. You know, heaven is a promised land for us. You know, the Lord promised that to us. Now, if you don't go to heaven, there's no other spot other than hell. There is no purgatory. There's no middle ground. There's either two options, either heaven or hell. So when you die, you're either going to heaven or you're going to hell. And he's letting you know right here that the unrighteous shall not get into the kingdom of God. You won't get in. You won't inherit it. You won't go there. And he's going to give you a list of the things that will stop you from getting there. Look what he says. Verse 9, he said, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. He said, be not deceived. Don't be tricked. Don't be bamboozled. Don't be fooled. He says, neither fornicators, you know, sleeping around, for you guys that's sleeping around with women that ain't your wife, better repent, man, or you ain't gonna make it in. For you women that's sleeping around with different men and ain't your husband, better repent, woman, or you ain't gonna make it in. Even if you're just sleeping with one person, you just shacked up together, y'all go to church every Sunday, you still ain't gonna make it in. You're gonna be one of the ones that says, Lord, 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 have we not did this and have we not done that? He gonna say, I never knew you. You're a fornicator and you're praying to him. He ain't hearing you. You living in sin. You gotta repent. You gotta turn away from that. Anyway, I wanna stick with idolatry. I get veered off real quick. But anyway, he said, be not deceived, neither fornicators nor idolaters. We're gonna stop right there. Idolaters. He said, idolaters won't make it in. Look what he says in verse 10. He finished the list. Nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers. Revilers is a 5-mile person, a cusser, using profanity, vulgar language. Can't be calling yourself a Christian and you're around here cussing. You ain't gonna make it into heaven like that. You need to repent. Okay, he says in verse 10, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. You're not gonna inherit the kingdom of God if you're an idolater. Y'all look at the whole list, study the whole list, but right now I want to focus on idolaters, because I'm dealing with the Catholic Church and these image worshiping and idols and stuff like that. You're not going to make it in. You can pray to Mary all day long, you ain't going to make it in. You can say 15 Hail Marys, you ain't going to make it in, because Mary is an idol. That's an image. That's an image of the real Mary. Why are you making an image of the real Mary anyway? Even you're not even supposed to make an image of Jesus Christ. Because God said in Exodus chapter 20 that we shouldn't make any graven image of anything down on earth, in heaven, or in under the water beneath. Don't make any image. Exodus chapter 20, read 1-5. He said don't make any image. So why are you making an image of Christ? Why are you making an image of Mary? Why are you making an image of St. Paul and all these other saints? Why are we making images of Santa Claus and putting it up in front of our house? That's an image. Who was Santa Claus? Santa Claus died for you? Who was Santa Claus? Did he really come down that chimney and give you a present? Huh? See, these are the ways of the heathens. These are the ways of the world. These are not the ways of God. You want to know the way of God? Read your Bible. Get your King James app. Read your Bible. You'll learn the ways of God. So, he says, an idolater shall not enter into the kingdom of God. Look. Look at Ephesians. Look at Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians, a couple of books down, chapter 5. Chapter 5, we're going to start in verse 5. He said, look at this now. This is a different book. And this is in the New Testament, dealing with idolatry. This is in the New Testament. He says, verse 5, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 5. He said, for this you know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of our God. Give you another list right here. Whoremonger, you know, all you playboys sleeping around with these different women, all you women are sleeping around with these different men, you know, none of y'all are going to have an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God unless you repent. There's always an unless. You know, You repent. You got to repent. You got to think differently. That ain't the life for you. That ain't the life God made you for. That ain't what he gave you that body for. That ain't what he, that is not, that's not of God, you know, to be a whoremonger. But anyway, back to idolatry. Idolatry. The Lord doesn't want us living in idolatry. He don't want us living in idolatry. He don't want us to be an idolater. He says that no idolater has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of our God. You don't have no inheritance there. You're not going to go there. You're not welcome there. You know, so you got to repent. You can't be an idolater and enter into the kingdom of God. You can't. You're not going to make it. It doesn't matter how many times you pray to Mary. It doesn't matter how many statues you got around it. It doesn't matter how much times you go to Catholic church every Sunday. If you're an idolater, you're not going to get into kingdom or the kingdom of God. That's why I'm doing this video, to tell you to repent. Turn away. Look at Galatians chapter 5. Tell you again, we're still in the New Testament. Galatians chapter 5. Look what he says, starting in verse 19. These things are the work of the flesh. We're in Galatians chapter 5, verse 19, and it reads, "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness." There you go, verse 20. Idolatry. It says witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, sedition, heresies, envy. Verse 21. Murderers, drunkenness, revellings, which are cusses, foul mouth people, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past. Look at this. That they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. That's what the word of God says. It said, if you do these things, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. Brother Joe ain't say this. Brother Joe ain't wrote one word in that Bible. Brother Joe ain't write one period, one comma, one quotation, nothing. I'm just telling you what thus says the Lord. He said you would not enter to the kingdom of God, saints. Whoever watching, if you're Catholic and you're watching this and you're an idolater, you're not going to make it into heaven unless you repent. So my message to you is to repent, man. Turn away from that. Man, woman, no matter what you are, repent. Turn away from that, because you're not going to make it in. Look what he says. Look what he says about the outcome of an idolater. I just read you three scriptures in the New Testament that shows you you're not going to make it into heaven. So if you don't make it into heaven, let's see where you go. Look at, turn to Revelations chapter 21 and verse 8. Revelations chapter 21, Revelations, for those of you that don't read your Bible, and I know especially the Catholic, y'all don't read your Bibles, man. Y'all don't study your Bibles. But the sad thing is, a lot of Christians don't read and study their Bibles either. Revelations is the last book in the Bible. Go to chapter 21 and verse 8. 21 verse 8, look what it says. This is, Revelations is speaking of the end times. This is judgment day. This right here is judgment day. This is the last day the Bible speaks about. But look what it says in Revelations 21 and 8. Because I read three scriptures to you that show you that if you're an idolater, or if you're living in idolatry, you will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. So for those of you who think, okay, well, I just won't make it in heaven, but I just roam the earth and just live in earth. No, you won't. You only got two options, heaven or hell. There is no purgatory. That's a lie. Catholic people lying to you. The Pope lying to you. There ain't no purgatory. I challenge you to go in your Bible. You can't even show me that in the Catholic Bible, purgatory. That's a man's made word. That's a man's made idea. That's a man's made concept. We are to live by scripture. Our scripture is our instructions, not the Pope. Okay, so there's no purgatory. There's either heaven or hell. If you're worshiping idols, if you got a statue of Jesus, a statue of Mary, and you're bowing down to it or praying to it, if you got pictures of this so-called Jesus in your house, that's an image. And if you are, and if you are adoring it, you putting it up, and you telling people, look at this is Jesus and all that old stuff, you ain't gonna make it into heaven. So if you don't make it into heaven, Revelation 21 and 8 gonna tell you where you're gonna go. It says, but the fearful, verse 8, Revelation chapter 21, verse 8, it says, but the fearful and unbelieving and abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers, here it come, and idolaters And all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. You ain't gonna make it into heaven. There is no purgatory. So being that there is no purgatory, there's a lake of fire. A lake of fire. Come on, man. Come on, woman. Do you really want to go there? You don't want to go there. You don't want to go there. Take them idols out of your house. Throw them in the trash. Break them up. Throw them in the trash. Snatch down the pictures of this Jesus, whose really name is Frank. That's the guy who really posed for that picture, and y'all calling him Jesus. Yeah, Frank or Tommy or William. You know, William stood there and took a picture. And they say, oh, thank you, Frank. Thank you, William. We really appreciate that. Huh, go put that in the store. Say that's Jesus. And everybody buying it. Everybody worshiping it, talking to it. That's an image. That ain't even an image of Jesus, because none of us know what he looked like. That's an image of Tommy. That's an image of William. We don't even know William. We're talking to William thinking that we're talking to Christ. And we ain't. That's silly, man. It's really silly, man. I'm guilty of that. I used to do that when I was young. I told you I was raised Catholic. I used to do that. So it's not like I'm belittling y'all or looking down on y'all, because I used to do that. You know, I used to do that same thing. You know, but until I had that experience with God, and God opened up my eyes, man, and God revealed to me that, you know, that ain't cool. I'm not crying. I'm just yarning. But, you know, just showing you, man, that ain't cool, man. That ain't a God, man. That ain't a God at all. So we got to stop doing that, because we're going to end up going to hell doing that. Look at us. So we see that it will send us to hell or the lake of fire. You know, for those of y'all don't understand why is it a hell and why is it a lake of fire, let me give you a brief example of that. Matter of fact, if you read Revelation chapter 20, read from like a verse 11 to like to verse 15. And that's telling you about Judgment Day. Judgment Day is when Christ comes back. When Christ comes back, that's it. You know, there will be time no more. Everything will be converted into eternity. Now, the thing is, where you're going to spend your eternity at? Will you go to heaven, or will you go to hell, or would you go to lake of fire? Okay, so when you look at the scenario of the hell and you see the lake of fire, you see Judgment Day. I'm going to use it like in America, right? America has laws. They set these laws up. If you break them, you know that there's going to be punishment. Okay? Let's look at a guy, right? The law says don't drink and drive. But this guy decides to break the law. So he breaks the law by getting drunk, and he's driving home, and he's swerving all over the street. A cop sees him, pulls him over, do a breathalyzer. Then he makes a judgment that this guy just broke the law. So he apprehends him. He put the handcuffs on him. And where do he take him? He take him to jail. All right. When he goes to jail, he's going to sit there until the day he goes to stand before that judge in the courtroom to be judged about his past actions. All right. When he goes to court, he goes before that judge. That judge sentences him. And now he goes to prison to do the duration of his time. Okay, so you got the laws, you got jail, you got the judge, and you got prison. Alright, look at it this way, because it's the same way in the spiritual realm, same way it's going to be on Judgment Day. God himself has set up laws. If we break those laws and we die as breaking those laws, like an idolater or a thief or a liar or a fornicator, if we die that way, because God give us a chance to get our life right through our lifespan. But the thing is, we don't know when we're going to die. We don't know when our time is going to end. So he's constantly letting us know that we need to repent. Okay, so if we don't repent and we die as a lawbreaker, we go just like that drunk driver goes to jail, we go to hell. And hell is just a holding tank until Judgment Day. And then when Judgment Day, the Bible tells you in Revelation chapter 20, as you read down from 11 to 15, it tells you that he'll bring the people out of hell. And they're going to stand before God for this Judgment Day and be judged according to all the things they've done, to the stuff that they did that wasn't right in the eyes of God. And then from there now, they're going to be sent to prison, which is the lake of fire. And that's where they'll spend eternity at. I don't want to go there, man. I don't know why you or anybody else would want to go there. I don't want to go there. So I'm not going to be an idolater anymore. I'm not going to worship images. I'm not worshiping Jesus or the statues or stuff. I'm worshiping Jesus. Yeah, the one that walked the earth 2,000 years ago, him. You know, the one that's in heaven on the right hand of God, him. Yeah, I'm worshiping him. Better believe I'm worshiping him through his. I'm worshiping God through his son, Jesus Christ. Yes, sirree. But that statue, no. The picture that people got in their houses, no. Mary, no. That's another Bible study we're going to have, too, about Mary. Is Mary an advocate? Can she be the advocate? We're going to talk about that after idolatry. So tune in for that one. I got to finish idolatry first, though. God wants me to finish it first. There's quite a few things I want to talk about. I want to talk about judge not that you be not judged. So this is for the street preachers, let you know. When people tell you that, don't listen to that. And I'm going to give you a Bible study about that. You can judge. We can judge. As a man of God, he that is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is judge of no man. In other words, don't you be a hypocrite. If you're out there preaching the gospel, make sure you're not on that list that you're preaching people not to be on. Amen. So let the Lord clean you up before you go out there. And when you get clean, now you're clean, you can go do that. Now, the root word for idolatry is idol. The root word for idolatry is idol. Now, let's look. Let's look on this dictionary right here. I got it coming up. Let's look what the word idol means, the definition of the word idol. Okay, so here's the definition of the word idol. It says, an image or other material object representing a deity to which religious worship is addressed. So it says, an idol is an image. Look at that word image. Because in Exodus chapter 20, from verse 1 through 5, God had warned us not to make any graven image. Any image. Any means none. Don't make any. Don't make no image of anything on earth, in heaven, or in the sea beneath. He said, don't make no image. And that's what an idol is. It's an image. It's like when you see the Jesus statue, that's an image. The Mary statue is an image. But it's an image. It's a figment of a man's imagination of who Jesus looks like. You know, with the long hair, white skin, blue eyes, blonde hair, and all that. Because nowhere in the Bible does it describe that Jesus had blue eyes, or that he had blonde hair, or that he was European, because he wasn't. The Bible said he was a Jew. All right, whether he was a light-skinned Jew or a dark-skinned Jew, it's irrelevant. This is a false image, and we shouldn't be making an image of anything. And that's what an idol is. It's an image or other material object representing a deity, because that's what it does. That's images. It's representing Jesus. It's representing Mary. But it's a false representation, because we do not know what that looked like. And even if we did, we are still instructed by Exodus chapter 20 to not make any image at all. Hey, so you saw that definition? You heard that? Ain't that something? Okay, now look in the New Testament what John said about it in 1 John. That's right before the book of Revelations. 1 John chapter 5. We're going to read that. Look what he says in verse 21. We're in 1 John chapter 5, verse 21. He says, my little children, keep yourselves from idols. He's telling you to keep yourself from idols. Look at also, and look at what also he said in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Go there right quick. Look at verse 14. Look what he said. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 14. He says, wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry. You know what idolatry is? Look, let's read that. Let's look at that. Let's see what it says about idolatry. What's the definition of idolatry? Look.
Okay, so if we want to look up this word idolatry, it's best to look it up in the Hebrew, in the Strong's Concordance, which is the Hebrew and Greek dictionary, to find out what that original word, what that word means. And this is a good Bible app to download on your phone. It's good to have a Strong's when you're reading your King James Bible, so when you run across words you don't know, you just look it up, man, and you look it up and you get the definition of it. And that definition, man, once you understand what that word means, it helps you to understand the scripture better also. Okay, so now we're going to look in the Strong's in the Bible app. And we're going to go over here. You click on that, and then you'll go to this window right here. And then you'll type in idolater. Put in I, then you put in the D-O-L, idolatry. Okay, and you see that idolatry is five times. It'll tell you how many times that word is in the whole entire Bible, from Genesis to Revelation. So you click on that. And it's going to tell you all that it's in, all the places that it's in. So we are going to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 14. That's where we at, where it says, "Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry." And you look up that word, the way you look that up, you see the number that's after the word idolatry, you click on that, which is 1495. You click on that, and it'll take you to this window. You look up top to make sure that's the same 1495. You didn't click on the wrong number. Then you come down and you look at the definition, the blue section, where it says definition, and it tells you right there, it says image worship. That is what idolatry is. It's image worship. It's all
okay. So he writes, "Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry." Saying, run, get away from idolatry. Get away from the statues of Mary. Get away from the statues of Jesus. Get away from the statues of Guadalupe. Get away from the statues of St. Paul, the statues of St. Patrick, the statues of St. Peter. Get away from that. Get away from the pictures of Jesus. All these pictures people got of Jesus. Every last one of them look different, but that's the same Jesus. Get away from the pictures. Get away. Flee from idolatry. Run for your life from idolatry. Why? Because you won't get into heaven if you stay next to it, if you worship it, if you keep that in your house. You won't get into heaven. I'm on this channel because I'm trying to get you, I'm trying to usher you in to heaven. You know, the Bible said it's not God's will that anybody should perish, but that all come to the knowledge of repentance. God wants you to repent. He wants you to turn away from that. Idolatry is image worship. That statue of Jesus is an image, and you worshiping it. You're adoring it. That's why you put it in your house. You got people going by and these big old statues, putting it on their front lawn of Mary. Putting a statue of Jesus, an image of Jesus on their front lawn. You adore that. Now, on the subject of idolatry, you know, the Bible said that all these things were written for our learning and our examples. That's why we had a Bible. So let's look at an example. In the New Testament, we're still in the New Testament. Let's look at Acts chapter 17. Yeah, I love the word of God, man, because it's your instructions, man. It's your instructions of life. B-I-B-L-E, Bible. Basic instructions before leaving earth. Let's read our instructions. Look at Acts. God is instructing us through scripture on how to live. Look at this. These are an example. We're in Acts chapter 17. Look at verse 16. This is good right here. For all y'all that say, "Oh, Joe, that was Brother Joe, that was in the Old Testament. We in the New Testament now. We can have statues of Jesus." No, you can't. That's a lie. That ain't the truth. Can't have no statues, can't have no images or nothing. All right, verse 16. Remember now, we're in Acts chapter 17, verse 16. I'm going to read 16 and 17, then I'm going to go down to 30 and 31. The purpose of this is, this is an example for us. This was Paul. This was the apostle. Look what happened. He says, "Now while," verse 16, "now while Paul waited for them at Athens," because they all came to Athens, him and the other disciples, and they was preaching the gospel. But he went on to Athens, and the other ones, they ain't came yet. So he was waiting for them. But while he was waiting, look what it says. "Now while Paul was waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly," and that word wholly means fully, "fully given to idolatry." He got upset. You see that? Look at that scripture. That's why I like to meditate on the scripture. I like to meditate on the scripture, and I like to visualize it. I like to visualize it, because that's getting deep. That's getting deep in the Word of God. So you don't want to just read the surface. You want to get in there, and you want to picture what you're reading so you can understand it better. He says, now while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him. He got upset. His spirit stirred up in him. Got restless in him, you know. And it says, when he saw the city fully given to idolatry. In other words, he got in this city. And I understand what he went through, because I went through this city, man. You know, like I said, I told y'all I'm a truck driver, man. Matter of fact, I'm in my truck right now. This the truck right here, man. You know, I'm at work. I'm at the truck stop. I'm at the TA. There go a truck right there coming. And you know, and I'm making this video, man. I'm at work, but I'm still making this video. I'm on my break, man. And I'm still making this video. This is my truck right there. So this is, I told y'all I got a job, man. This is what I do. You know, Bible says, if a man don't work, he shall not eat. God bless me with a good job. I get a chance to see the whole United States for free. You know, I get a chance to eat in restaurants all over the country. So I thank God for, well, that ain't for free, but you know, I make pretty good money to do it and take care of my family. You know, little things like that. But anyway, so yeah, I'm in my truck, so I'm just letting you know I'm making this video from the truck. But what I was trying to tell you is that I went in this city. I went in this state. I think I was in New Mexico. Yeah, I was in New Mexico somewhere. I forgot the name of the city. And I noticed as I got in there, man, they had all these aliens pictures everywhere, man. All these statues of aliens, green aliens, all over the city. And it stirred me up inside. I'm like, man, what is wrong with these people, man? Why they got all these aliens there? And the people said, I asked when I went inside of the store, a truck stop, I asked the lady, why has this city got so many statues of aliens? And she was like, oh, you don't know? You know, back in, I forgot when she said it was, that something crashed in their city. And they think that it was an alien, and they said the police cover it up, and the police said that no, it was some craft of theirs that they did, and now everybody thought it was aliens, and so now they didn't got the whole city painted with aliens. There's alien statues everywhere. It's crazy, man. It's like you're on a Hollywood set when you ride through there with all these aliens and stuff, man. It's crazy, man. But I understand how Paul felt, man. And that's how I felt when I go in some of these Catholic churches, man, and I see all these images and statues of Jesus and statues of Mary. I feel the same way he felt. You know, Paul got upset about this. And look, I'm going to read that in verse 16 again. He said, now while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city fully given to idols. You know, they were fully given to idols. And look at verse 17. He said, therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons, and in the market daily with them that met with him. Okay, so he disputed. That word disputed means he argued. He argued with them every day. It said daily. So it ain't like one day out of the week he did it. He did this daily. Why? Because of the things that he saw. You know, for some of y'all that seen me in those videos, and it seems like I'm arguing with the Catholic people. It seems like I'm arguing with the church. You know, I am, because my spirit was stirred when God led me to that place, and I went in there and I seen this place is fully given to idols. This is supposed to be the house of God, and you got statues of Jesus, statues of Mary, images of the cross. All these are images. You don't need that. You don't need that. We don't need that stuff. These things make God mad. These things make God angry. You know, so. He said, therefore disputed he in the synagogue, verse 17, with the Jews and with the devout persons, and in the market daily with them that met him. Now look at this. This is very important. Go to verse 29. This is very important right here, what I'm about to read. This is going along with the same story. I'm just, you know, going down a little bit. You can read that whole story if you want, but I'm just, I just want to focus on the highlighted stuff. All right, so now. Look what he says in verse 29. Look what Paul's saying. Paul then gathered these people up. They got all these images and statues everywhere. Paul gathered these people up, and look what he said. This is very important, man. These very two verses, man, is very important for anybody that's Catholic or anybody who call themselves a Christian and got statues in their house or images in their house. Anybody who's bowing down on their knees and praying to these statues, man, look at what he's saying. Verse 29, he got upset. Now, a man of God has a right to get angry. The Bible said, be ye angry, but sin not. You can get angry. Jesus was angry. You know, if you read your Bible, Jesus went inside the synagogue and seen what they was doing, and he tied a cord around. He dragged all the tables out in anger. I'm sure people would say, "No, that wasn't godly." Yes, it was. That was a righteous anger, man. God get mad. Jesus get mad. We can get mad as long as we don't cuss nobody out, as long as we don't physically touch nobody or put our hands on nobody or even threaten anybody. We ain't supposed to do that as a Christian. But you can get mad when you see it. Just like when you see a child do something wrong. You told this child not to do this, and you turn around and see him do it, you get angry. Well, so we get angry when we see people doing something wrong. Anyway, verse 29. He said, "For as much then as we are of the offspring of God," he said, "we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone graven by art and man's device." He's letting you know, we ought not to think that the Godhead has anything to do with silver, gold, or graven image, like a statue of Jesus, or the statue of Mary, or the statue of Guadalupe, or the statue of anything, or image of anything that we're saying, this is God, this is Jesus, or this is Mary. You know, he said, we ought not to think that. Look what he says now. Look what he says. The next verse 30. In verse 30 he says, "And the times of this ignorance God winked at." That word "winked at" means overlook. God overlooked certain things that we've done in our past. He says, "But now commanded all men everywhere to do what?" That's that word you don't hear in your church no more. You don't hear that today in church. Repent. You don't hear that. You know what you hear in church? Pay your tithes. God love you. God gonna bless you. Oh, you sick? God gonna heal you. Oh, God got a blessing for you. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. God gonna bless you. That's what you, man. Listen. God is all that. But if you living right, if you ain't living right, God is none of that. Okay? So you expect God to bless you, you gotta live right. That's it. You know, you gotta not walk in sin. You know, if you make a mistake, yeah, if you sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ. You know, ask him for forgiveness, but turn away from that. Repent. Think differently. But anyway, he says in verse 30, he says, and the times of this ignorance God's winked at, but now commanded all men everywhere to repent. Why? Look what he says in verse 31. This is the key. Why? Why he wants all men to repent? He tell you. He give you the answer in verse 31. He starts it off with because. He said, because he had appointed a day in the which he would judge the world in righteousness by that man who he had ordained. He gonna judge the world by Jesus. That Jesus is the one. Jesus is the man that he ordained. Jesus says that all power and authority has been given to him. Okay. So with that being said, there's a day. Look what he says. Because he had appointed a day in which he would judge the world. God gonna judge the world. Well, judgment day is coming. Do you want to be an idolater on judgment day? Do you want to be a statue worshiper on judgment day? I don't want to do that. I want you to hear me. I want you to go search the scriptures to see if it's so. And I want you to get right with God and repent. That's what I want. I want you to go to heaven. I don't want you to go to hell. I ain't go out there to say, ha-ha, I told you, now you're going to hell. Nah, that ain't what I'm doing. I want you to repent like I repent. I denounce the name Catholic. I don't even call myself no Catholic. And I definitely don't call myself no Baptist, no Pentecostal, no Trinitarian, no Lutheran, none of that. No, I'm just a Christian. Just a Christian. That's all I am. You know what the definition of Christian is? One who follows Christ. That's who I am. One who follows Christ. The Bible don't never speak about Catholic. Never. Never speak about Catholic. Not even one time. That word ain't nowhere in the Bible. The Bible says in Acts chapter, the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. That's what they were called. Why? Because they saw the disciples doing the same thing that Jesus did, so they called them Christians. And people said that was a mockery. I don't know about that being a mockery. The Bible didn't say that was a mockery. The definition is that you're a follower of Christ. And even if it was a mockery and you suffer for that, guess what Paul says? If any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed. So, if you want to laugh at me for holding that name Christian and talk about me and laugh at me and every day, hey, that's all good. I'll suffer. I ain't gonna be ashamed. I ain't gonna feel ashamed. You're the one gonna be ashamed on the day of judgment if you don't become a Christian yourself. So, brothers, that's what we talked about. We talked about idolatry. I'm gonna go a little further with it too. I'm gonna go back to the Old Testament. And if you get a chance, man, read Exodus chapter 20, verse 1 through 5 again, and then read Exodus chapter 32, the whole chapter. And I'm just going to give you a little highlight of it, man. You know, God already said in chapter 20 not to make any graven image at all. And you know, the children of Israel, God, they was in slavery, and God brought them. He delivered them by his mighty, powerful wonders, man. Delivered them by the hand of Moses and brought them out of Egypt. And he brought them into the wilderness just for a moment, because he was going to take them into the promised land, which was Canaan. But a lot of them didn't make it into the promised land. They didn't make it. You know why? Because they sinned against God. Guess how they sinned against God? They made a molten image. They took all their gold, all their jewelry, all their silver, and they melted it down, because Moses was in the mountain with God for 40 days and for 40 nights. He was communicating with God. Him and God was talking one-on-one. And this is where God had revealed so much stuff to Moses. He didn't just reveal to him the Ten Commandments. He took Moses all the way back to how everything began. Because remember, Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. How can Moses write about Adam and Eve and Cain and Abel and Nimrod and the days of Noah and Abraham and Isaac and Jacob? The only way he knew all that is because God revealed everything to him. God told him that, revealed all that to him. So while he was spending time with God, the people down there got impatient. They start saying, wait a minute, man. Where Moses at? Moses been gone for a minute, man. Hey, man, we got to get out of here, because they're trying to get into the promised land. But see, when God promised you something, you just got to wait. You just got to be patient. Because if you don't wait, you make stupid decisions. Stupid choices can lead you straight to hell. Those choices can get you killed, destroyed. The children of Israel got impatient. They ran to Aaron and told him, we need something to get us up out of here, because we don't know what happened to Moses. And instead of Aaron saying, you know what? We're going to trust God. God ain't brought us out here to destroy us. God ain't left us. God going to bring us. He's faithful to bring us into that promised land. So we're going to wait, every last one of y'all. Instead of him saying that, he went on ahead and started doing what they told him to do. So he came up with the idea to take all, because it's thousands and thousands and thousands of them. And all of them had gold and jewelry and all kind of stuff they had from the Egyptians. You know, they was wealthy with that gold and jewelry, man. But they took that blessing that God gave them, and they melted it down, and they made them a calf, a golden calf. Look, I'm going to show you on the thing what it looked like. This is what they did. This is what the children of Israel, they made a cow, which was a calf. They made a cow. And they worship this cow. Look at it.
You see what it was when they was looking at these golden calves, when they melted down the gold, the silver, and they did all these things, and Aaron melted it down, and then he took it out of graven tool, and they made a cow. This is so crazy to me, man. But I mean, this is just what we do, man. When we ain't following the instructions of God, man, we do stupid stuff. They made this cow out of all the gold they had and the silver they had. They made this cow because they wanted to make an image, and they wanted this image to worship it, man. And that's what they was doing. They was worshiping. Here's another one. This is just giving you a picture of what they doing. They made that cow and it was worshiping. Here's another one.
Yeah. That's an image of a cow. God said don't make any image. They did a cow back then. We doing Mary today. We making images of Mary today and worshiping it. We are making images of Jesus and we worshiping it. That's not the Jesus that we're supposed to worship. We're going to worship him through things that man made in their hands. We got to worship him in spirit and in truth. All you got to do is close your eyes and say, Father God, in the name of Jesus, and make your request known. That's all you got to do. You ain't got to bow down to no statue. Okay, that's going to go ahead and wrap it up for today. This is Idolatry is a Sin, part 3. I encourage you to stay tuned for part 4, and that's going to be the last one on idolatry. I just try to, you know, hit all the scriptures that's dealing with idolatry, because, you know, the Bible tells us that these things in the scriptures was written for our learning, our example, you know. So these are examples of how God feels about idolatry and how people was punished and dealt with because of idolatry. And you know, so I'm gonna go ahead in part 4, which is the last one. We're gonna go to Exodus chapter 32, and we're gonna see how God, after he told them not to make any images, how they went on ahead and made these images, and we're gonna see what happened and how God feel about that. So these things are written for our learning and our example. Also, the Bible says that all scripture was inspired by God, you know, for reproof, for correction, for instructions. You know, so when we're doing something wrong, the scripture would correct us. You know, and the scriptures is our instructions on how to live right in the eyes of God. We can't do things our way. The Bible warns us in Proverbs not to be wise in your own opinion. You know, for people to say, well, you know, the reason why I got a statue of Jesus is because, you know, that's my way. It's like I'm looking at him. That's your way. You're being wise in your own opinion. And you making these statues of Mary, the same thing. You know, you think that that's the right way. But the Bible says that there's a way that seemed right to a man, but the end thereof is death. That's the end of that. Death. Death means separation, separated from God. If God is in heaven and you die in sin as an idolater, you're going to be separated from God. To be separated from God, you ain't going to be in heaven. You're going to be in hell. So basically, this is just a warning, man. To turn away from that mess. It ain't worth it. It ain't worth it, for real. So, and I pray, man, that whoever's Catholic is watching this, I pray that you don't get offended, but that you sit there and read the scriptures, and you just make it up at the end of your day. You just make your mind up, hey, man. You know, I don't like the way he presented that. I don't know, like, how he keep attacking the Catholics. I don't like how he keep talking about my images and statues. But at the end of the day, he right. This is what the Word of God say. Your Catholic Bible will tell you the same thing that the Bible, the King James Bible, said. Just don't go in the King James Bible. That's the Bible I go by. But go by the Catholic Bible. Those same scriptures that I'm reading to you is in your Catholic Bible. Read that. Okay? And it'll tell you. All right? So, basically, like I said, I'm in my truck, man. I'm working right now. And I'm going to end this video right now. I'm going to give a shout-out to my wife, man. I know a lot of y'all, man, y'all see on my page, there's a woman on there. Y'all might wonder who that woman is. That's my wife. You know, that's my wife. That's my gift from the Lord. And I'm in Massachusetts right now, and I know she's going to see this video because I'm going to upload it. So I just want to say, hey, babe, love you. I'll be home in a minute. This will show y'all a truck that I drive. I'm a car hauler. Showed y'all that I'm inside the truck. Yeah, so that's what I do for a living. I'm a car hauler, you know, and that's what I do. I drive cars. So anyway, man, I just want to let y'all know, man, you know, keep trusting God. Be obedient to God, and we'll make it into heaven. We'll always make it to heaven if we be obedient to God. All right? So, man, y'all go ahead. Y'all go in grace. I love y'all. God bless y'all. Stay tuned for part 4. That's going to be the last one. And the one I'm going to work on after that is Mary is not an advocate, because the Catholic people think that Mary is an advocate. She is not an advocate. We're going to go through a Bible study about that, too. All right? I love y'all. God bless you. Peace.
Till my eyes close, I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. Soon as I wake in the morning, I knock my idols down. I ain't gonna quiet down, I know these haters hate my sound. I set the atmosphere when I step on this battlefield. I fear no man but God, if you wait, God, I have no fear. These empty souls from Egypt drinking from an empty well. They saying no to Jesus just like saying yes to hell. You try to do it your way always seems to fail. Digital scales and bullet shells lead you to a cell. Renew this mind of mine, cause man, the streets polluted me. They sanctify me in the process of you grooming me. Sometimes it's better to react with no reaction. Hey, even in the midst of disturbance and all distraction, I say, I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm repping Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. Before I met him, I had on that bird box blindfold. I couldn't see like Jamie Foxx on a movie raid. But now I'm covered by the blood and damn at the Kumite. Now I understand Jesus is who I'm living for. I ask the Holy Ghost to refill me daily and give me more. The way he saved my life, can't explain it, it's just a miracle. To heaven's where I'm going in the end. What? Seminole. I don't want the glory. No. It's not for me. No. He stopped me dead in the middle. Huh? Apostrophe. Since then I have been raised in Christ. What? Colossians 3. Keep your eyes on the Savior instead of watching me. Yeah. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. I'm screaming Jesus, Jesus, Jesus till my eyes close. See, it's my weakest points in life though when you make me strong. Destination restoration, what we living on. If you ain't dripping for Jesus, man, then you dripping wrong. Cause every lesson in my life has been a stepping stone.